Welcome to session 5 of the series, The Vital Approach. As mentioned in the previous session, we will continue with the animal kingdom. This class will be about mammals and birds. There are some mammals who were in our anterior medica from the beginning. Lately, more have been proved and added to our repertory. Furthermore, we will talk about birds, a realm we have only discovered recently. And we'll clarify how to recognize mammals and birds in practice. Enjoy this session.
In session 4, we learned about the general features of the animal kingdom and talked about two well-known subkingdoms, spiders and snakes. And we made a differential diagnosis between the two. Another well-known subkingdom is the mammals, of which we have a well-known representative, Lacanino. This is a classical remedy and we have a lot of rubrics in our classical Materia Medica. Many of those rubrics belong to the whole subkingdom and not to the species of Lacanino only. That's the reason why the remedy is or tends to be overprescribed. For instance, the delusion to be looked down upon, the delusion to be despised, the delusion to be dirty, belong to the whole subkingdom and not only to the dog, to Lacanino itself. There are rubrics like violence, anger, rage even, malice, and a lot of symptoms with milk that belong to the whole subkingdom. So what is specific to Lacanino then, you can ask? Well, as I've seen in cases, the feeling of being of second class is typical for this species. You don't find it in other mammal remedies. Also, there are issues about loyalty, or you can find problems or issues with hierarchy and your place in the pack. So why do we have these different aspects, you can ask, in just one remedy? We don't find them in our books, but we find them in our patients. According to my understanding, the reason for this is that we talk about a domesticated animal here. And domesticated animals living close to humans, you could say, became more or less a bit human and are object to our projections. Or we see in the dog a loyal friend, and there are loyal friends, or we project the idea of the dirty dog, you know, it's very low, and I'm only a dog, and I work like a dog. Or we project a more instinctive behavior that belongs to the place of the animal in the pack. And the same applies to Lacanino, another domesticated animal, that is an object of a lot of our projections. For instance, we see in Lacanino the hard-working horse. It works hard for the boss, and even when it's badly treated, it reacts with, I will work harder. Or Lacanino can be very, very fearful when it's alone, because we know it's a herd animal, and being alone means you are prey. Or we can project the idea of a running free and in the fields, which is true for Lacanino, or at the seashore we have those pictures and these images, and of course that is what a horse likes to do, to run free. But in the domesticated horse, and almost all horses we see now are domesticated, they prefer a secluded territory, a secure territory, which is a bit strange, but that is what we find in our patients. We can see these different aspects in another species, for instance, Lacleonino. It will present completely different in a male patient as in a female patient, because the male patient, we know from the rubric, from the proving, will have this autumn-like air, talking with an air of command, and they have a tendency to fight, and if they're involved in fighting, they will fight to the finish, or they will have issues with their offspring and taking care for the children or protecting their children or fighting for their children. And in the female, we don't have this fighting so much, but they will be like a lioness with their whelps, you know, they will protect them and they will go through fire in order to protect them. Now, what are these general mammal features? What conclusions can we make so far? Because the mammals are so diverse, and in themselves, we see in one remedy different aspects. We have different groups. We have the predators and the prey, and of course, they will have a completely different experience. Though sometimes in the predator, we have the, how do you say, the consciousness, the awareness of what they do to their prey. We have other groups. Some mammals live in groups, in packs, in families, and others are loners. So depending on their lifestyle, as I can put it that way, and the environment, they will have different aspects. But what I expect to see, what I like to see in all mammals, is something with milk. Milk or lactation, as you can see on the scheme. What do I mean with this? It is lack, after all. We take the milk from the mammal, and this is something in common to all mammal remedies. They all give milk to their young. So in our patients, how will this present? Most likely there will be problems with breastfeeding. For instance, a woman complains that she is not or was not able to breastfeed her child. Or they have an exaggerated importance on breastfeeding. So they emphasize it, they're focused on it, it's completely taken by this period of breastfeeding. It has too much weight, too much importance. Or, as I've seen in cases, the symptoms start when the breastfeeding stops, because they like it so much, or they think it's so important that the moment the situation demands to stop it, or even the child doesn't want any breastfeed any longer, then the problem with the mother starts. Now you can say that all mothers will have some, at least some care, some worry, some interest in breastfeeding. But in a mammal case, it's overemphasized. It's on the foreground. It's too much. And that's what will put your mind to mammals. Of our patients, who are many of them mothers, not all of them will talk about breastfeeding. Not everybody will talk about these worries or these anxieties about children in the same way. We could say they are a bit overprotective. And if they talk about their cares or their love for the baby, it is a little bit, and I think it's, I choose the word with care, it's a little bit instinctive. You know, the bodily functions are expressed in instinctive behavior, and especially in the field of procreation. So it could be that the mother is carrying the baby or the young child all of the time close to her body. Or she likes to feel it, to touch it, to smell it. She keeps it with her day and night. I even had a patient who said, my baby slept on my belly for 6 months. Then it was put next to her, still in the bed. And then after maybe 9 or 10 months, the baby was in a little bed, in the cradle, next to her bed, but she still, it was still within her reach, and she could touch the baby whenever she wanted throughout the night. So this is a little bit more than average, wouldn't you think? In the man, in the male patient, we probably don't see this behavior, because of course they don't have this lactation and these milk issues, but they will be very protective towards their children. I recall a case, it was published in the Charm of Homeopathy, of a Lacleoninum case, where the problem started when his first and only child was born. And what started was the sleeplessness. From that moment on, and he did make the connection himself, but it was very specific, as the child was born, he started sleeping. He stopped sleeping, or he had a very light sleep. And he even said, my child, when it was 2 years old or something, used to fell out of the bed now and then. And even before she touched the ground, I woke up and I just could catch her. And that is very quick, very, very quick. Another example is the Lac Lupinum cases, where they have the issues with babies and not only caring for the babies, but saving the babies, dreams and delusions that they have to save the babies. Another aspect of mammals is the domineering, and depending on which side of the spectrum they belong, predators or prey, they will domineer, be dominant, or feel dominated. Another word you can find on the schemes is the group. That's a very broad idea, and it represents the, or it could represent the family, the group they belong to, or the friends even, which are in some mammal cases very important, a very prominent place in their life is their friends, or even bigger groups, it can be colleagues. And the need for the group is for safety and protection, and in those cases it's a matter of life and death, because if they are isolated from the group, isolated from the herd, then there is a danger to their life. For instance, we had the Lac Delphinum case, a boy of 11 years old, and he was still a schoolboy, of course, and what he was telling us, or telling me, is that he was very helpful towards his colleagues, towards his friends in school, and to everybody. He said that he would, for instance, borrow his swimming suit if somebody else forgot it, or he would carry their books, or he would, when they didn't make their homework, he would give his homework to the others. And when I asked him if he would like, if he liked this, if he, why did he do this, he actually said, because not always I like it, but I want to stay in the group. So he would gone a long way to stay in the group, even doing things that he didn't particularly like, or he didn't even thought they were right, or they were very unpleasant for him, because then he couldn't swim and somebody else used his swimsuit. But in order to stay in the group, he would sacrifice in this way. The group can also bring about some kind of conflict, because the person wants to somehow assert his individuality, yet stay in the group. So it can be a clash of interests, like my interest versus the interests of the group. And then the person tries hard to keep some individuality, try to be himself, and yet be part of the group. Aggression is a feature that I think we find in all animal remedies, and we will find in mammals just the same. Again, depending on which side the person actually is situated, on the side of the aggressor or the side of the victim. Now, in an aggressor, then of course the aggression will be expressed when angry, and then the feeling will be wanting to kill. And this can be wanting to bite, wanting to devour, or expressed as wanting to jump on somebody, or bite his throat, or corner him, or chase him, or scratch him, or slaughter, fight, finish off, whatever synonym you can think of. But the idea is have him, kill him, finish him. And if you're on the side of the victim, then there's a fear, and there's an intense fear of the attack, a fear to be chased, to be run after, to be persecuted, to be bitten. And I even heard patients saying bitten parts off their body, arms and legs, and be torn apart, being eaten, devoured, swallowed, and the general idea is again being killed. But in that way, it is a violent death. And the emphasis is on the danger. There's always a danger, or there's a threat, and it can be or in the daily life, in the fears, or very often in the nightmares. Another word you will find on the scheme is friends. We already said when we had the word groups that friends can be very, very important in the life of a mammal. For instance, like equinum, we know that they are very sensitive to quarrels. They can't stand their friends quarreling, not even quarrels with them, but their friends among them. So they will do everything to prevent people quarreling, and they will go a long way to have peace and harmonious relationships. The big cats, on the other hand, most of them are loners, and then in those cases the friends are not that prominent. We find another characteristic on the scheme, antagonism with self. And we already saw this in the snakes. In snakes, it is represented as two wills, or even split will or split tongue. And in mammal cases, it is a little bit of nuance, but we will find it as a conflict, an inner conflict between two tendencies. And it is said it's a tendency of the mammal and the human in the same person. Mm? In most mammal cases, I expect to hear fear, intense fear, and mostly many fears, all kind of fears. Like the common ones, fears of heights and fears of robbers, fears of dark, fears of accidents. But mainly, and these are proving symptoms, and we shouldn't forget that homeopathy or homeopathic remedy pictures are based on provings in the ideal case. And the proving symptoms brought about that almost all animals have a fear of snakes. It can sound funny, but that's what the provings brought about. Fear of fire and fear of falling. And I must say, I can confirm this from clinical practice. In many, many mammal cases, we find those fears very outspoken. So, in animal cases, in many times, we hear the patient mention a lot of animals. And that is sometimes a big problem, because which animal to choose? They can, for instance, say they love cats, or they are very fond of dogs, and dogs are their best friends. And they can have, the same patient can have an intense fear of sharks, for instance, or let's say disgust for spiders, and then we will not know what to choose, which animal of all those animals mentioned that we have to choose. It is not a good idea then to ask direct questions. For instance, to ask, what animal do you particularly like? Because then we have a risk that we encourage the patient to project his animal feelings in an ideal animal. Let's say then maybe he will identify with the lion or with the eagle or whatever animal that he admires. And he will give all kind of qualities that he would like to have. It's not necessarily the qualities the patient has. It's not necessarily the sensation that are deep inside himself. I must say, very often, they're most likely just the contrary. So, what could we ask? What is better? In those cases, we have to find out if he loves a cat, what in the cat is it particularly that he loves? If he is fond of horses, why horses are appealing to him? And let him describe in all details. If he has a fear of sharks, what in the shark is so fearful to him? What is so scary? If you think spiders are just really disgusting, what in the spider is so disgusting to him? And if we have all those characteristics, we might as well end up with a rabbit. And this could be an animal that he never mentions, because the patient doesn't know. We know what we're looking for, but he doesn't know. And we try to make the interview as natural as possible and not lose ourselves in imaginations. But fortunately, a lot of patients come up with a coherent pattern. They will tell you about the remedy after open questions. We don't ask suggestive questions. As we know, we are very careful to have open questions. And after careful questioning, little by little, they give you piece after piece after piece. And in the end, you have a coherent pattern like a puzzle. You have different pieces of a puzzle all pointing to one and the same animal. And they will give you the characteristics, or they will give you a piece of the puzzle in their dreams. And then, for confirmation, you can push a little bit, ask a little bit more, and say, you talked about this animal, or you talked about this animal, can you say a little bit more? And then, often, as the final confirmation, with hand gestures and all, they will just go into the sensation, and this is very exciting. Then they really act the animal, they speak the animal, they do the animal before your eyes, and then there's no doubt about it. So we do have those cases, of course, but not all cases are like that. That's why I said it's careful questioning, and it's when you're not sure, or you end up with different possibilities of different mammals or different animals, then you have to go for the characteristics of every animal mentioned so far. So that's enough for mammals now. I'd like to tell you a little bit more about another subkingdom, birds. Birds are very common, yet they were not prescribed 20 years ago, 15 years ago, I think. They were just an unknown group of remedies. And now that we have them available, we see that a lot of our patients need bird remedies. They are really common, but they are very easily overlooked because a lot of them don't display the very clear animal kingdoms animal features we talked about so far. So I think the first provings of birds are somewhere in the 90s, situated in the 90s, and these were the provings of eagle, of falcon, and of hawk. The three of them, all predators. So we had, of course, it's predictable, rubrics like violence and anger and rage and competition and speed. There's a lot of speed in birds in general, and a lot of survival issues. But I must say, a lot of bird cases I've seen are not predator birds, and so these features are absent. So how to spot a bird in that case? In the same way that I expect to hear milk or lactation in a mammal case, I expect to hear freedom in a bird case, no matter whether it's a predator bird or not. I know everybody wants to be free, so that's a very, very common characteristic, and we will hear a lot of our patients talk about freedom, because it's common to all humans. We don't like to be engaged, or we don't like to be enclosed or limited in our freedom. But in a bird case, it is the vital issue. It is the motivation for doing things or not doing things. It is the last answer to your question. Why do you do this? How do you feel? And that's where it's all about, the freedom. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, the opposite of it is the feeling of being trapped and feeling engaged. And often they will use those words, not limited, but really trapped or engaged. And the freedom is their vital issue. That's what they need in order to feel okay, you know. I know it's close to tubercular myosin, doesn't it? It sounds like, oh, well, what's the difference then? We have tubercular patients, why don't we give them tuberculinum? The freedom issue and the need to be free, or the feeling that you are enclosed when you cannot have your freedom, sounds like tubercular myosin indeed. But birds are animal after all. So we'll hear somewhere in the case, somehow, some comparison. It's very much more subtle than the competition and the fight to be the best. It's not like in mammal cases. It will be very subtle, but the comparison will be somewhere there, and the instinctive issues that are typical for all animal cases. About this tubercular myosin, I think there is a little misunderstanding about or between the myosin and the sensation in birds, in the same way that we often hear or read that spiders and insects belong to the tubercular myosin. Again, this is a confusion between the characteristics of the spider, we talked about it in the last session, the speediness, the restlessness, the wanting to move. This is tubercular. But it is the sensation, the feeling, the nature, you can say, of the spider and of the insects. So it's not the myosin. The myosin is a coping up mechanism. It's with the problem, how do you cope with it? How do you manage your problem? So that's a different thing altogether. And the same mistake sometimes, or the same confusion, is seen in birds the confusion with tubercular myosin. Like birds must be tubercular because they want to be free, because they need air, because they want change, otherwise they feel trapped and engaged. But that's, again, a coping up mechanism of something. While in birds, it's their vital issue, in other words, their sensation. As milk was necessary to make you think of a mammal, a waterproof word to make your mind go to birds is the word eye, the word vision, focus, overview, panorama, high, whatever synonym you can find, but that's the idea. There's something with the eye in birds. The eye is very prominent. Either it is a problem with the eye, very often they do have problems with the eye, but it's the way they will express or they will use, unconsciously use the words, or will have a tendency to have this overview, this look, this focus, this sharpness of vision, for instance, or the panorama, which is another word of saying that you have an overview. This will be in all bird cases. I don't think you will miss one. And of course, I said sky. Most birds fly in the sky. Not all birds, though. So we have, again, a vast group that are that need to be grouped or listed in subgroups. Same as spiders. We said we have so many spiders and we need to have subgroups. And the same with birds. We have the ducks and the geese and the swans and the pheasants and a lot of those birds, they do fly, but they like to roam in the fields, and often we will hear this, that they have the freedom to roam and to walk about in the fields. Although they can fly, it's not prominent. Other birds, we have the water birds, we have singing birds, we have migrating birds. Of course, in those birds, the flying and the long distances and the movement of the flying and the bee to be high in the sky will be much more important. We have some birds who are really acrobats. You can't believe it, but some patients really do this just to show you or almost feel this being in the air, this speed, this air, this wind, when they're, as they are flying. And sometimes you could say they almost fly in your office. And we have other birds, like parrots. They can fly, but it won't be so prominent. But in general, let's say, all birds, what they have in common is they have feathers, they have wings, and they can fly. So that's their biotope, that's their natural element, the sky and the flying and being high in the sky. It is possible that they would, like pheasants and geese and ducks, that they would maybe rather use the word floating than flying, because they don't fly much, or they don't fly if not necessary, or when domesticated they might not fly at all. In all birds we can find an emphasis on the care of the children. Maybe it's common to all animals, but it's very outspoken in bird cases. We could say that the birds, they sit like a chicken on their eggs. So they're very protective for their children. They really try to be good mothers and fathers, good parents. The motherhood, the parenthood is very important. They have a lot of anxieties for their children, that something would happen to their children. Or they read books about being good parents, or follow courses, because it's very important in their life. In general, all birds have a quick metabolism. So very often we hear big appetite, increased appetite, and a tendency for diarrhea, which is white and slimy. On the scheme you can find eyes, ears, and bones, and these are the areas where we find the most problems with the birds. I already mentioned the eyes, eye problems, problems with vision, problems with the ears. Very often it is something with the equilibrium, with the balance. Or they have noises in the ears, that's another problem, or deafness. And with the bones, that's very general, of course, with the skeleton. They can have all kinds of problems with the skeleton, but just the combination of these things will make your mind go to birds. Now, and this applies to the mammal cases as well, and in fact to all sub-kingdom cases. It's never only one feature. It's not because a person only once used the word focus or the patient maybe just once mentioned something with breastfeeding, that will already fix the subkingdom. It's never just one feature. It's always, and that's important, the whole pattern. So different things have to come together and make a pattern. So it must be either and the physical symptoms and let's say a mind symptom and a specific expression and a specific nightmare, and it all points to the same direction. It's not because a person talked a little bit about freedom, maybe encouraged by something you asked, that you say we are in bird kingdom. It's never only their looks, only that one word, only that one endeavor, only that fascination, only that like or dislike for a particular species. It must come all together and must form, that's what I mean with the pattern, must form one whole, like a puzzle. That's all pieces of the same puzzle. Fortunately, often our patients will help us in some way. If we already determine the kingdom and the subkingdom, and then we're left with the question, which bird would this person need? Very often they will give you a hint. For instance, I once had a patient, and we understood by her dreams of flying and some other features that she needed a bird, and she could describe in her dreams very precisely how she was flying in and out houses. So we understood that it was a bird that lived close to humans and that was used to humans. And then she said, somehow, I don't know how it came about, when I was in my 20s, I started to sing. And we asked about the singing, and she said, it just came spontaneously. I was in a bar and there was music, and they asked me to sing a song, and it was my favorite song. And I just spontaneously started to sing. And everybody was so moved about my voice, and I was even surprised. And then she started to describe in all details how the sound came from deep and passing through her throat with all this vibration, and how it was in her mouth, the sound, and how beautiful it sounded. Well, she ended up with canary. And another patient, he was telling us about his period when he was a student, when he used to hang out at night in the trees, he said, which is a very unlikely thing to say, and he ended up with night owl. Another patient that needed the remedy of the bird kingdom, because the freedom or the need to be freedom was clear in the case. He didn't want to marry, he didn't want to have children, and all of it was focused on the danger that he could lose his freedom. Even with the child, he said, just imagine the child is handicapped. That's for your life, he said. So even that was a reason not to start to take the risk to have children for him. Freedom was the most important thing. He had the dreams of flying, he had the startling. A lot of birds are startled very easily. They have this sometimes these quick movements, these quick eye movements or body movements, and the starting. But then, which bird? So we questioned him about his travels, because he was a traveler. He made a lot of travels. And that's also typical for birds. They like to see other countries. They like to go everywhere. But which bird? And then finally, he gave us a clue by his fascination and fear for the statues in Egypt of the ibis. And he did very well on ibis. So, I wish you a lot of luck and success with your bird spotting. Now I can hear you say, what about insects? Because insects do fly as well, don't they? And yes, you're right. They do fly, and they have dreams of flying, and it can be a little bit confusing in the beginning. But fortunately, we have some other features that will help us to distinguish between the two. So we don't have this particular need, this vital issue of freedom. It's not so prominent. We don't hear it on the foreground. We do hear, which is a bit funny, I admit, a focus on hair. I don't know why, but in insect cases, very often we hear that the patient has a particular attention, a particular interest, a particular emphasis on his hair, the way his hair looks. If he has enough hair, not losing hair, if his hair is nice, or he or she will color their hair, or they will do a lot of things to have, in order to have nice hair. We won't find this in birds. This is quite specific to insects. Of course, there are so many insects and so many species we don't know, that we haven't even discovered. And we have to do what we can for the time being with what we already know from maybe 10 remedies, 15 or 20 remedies of which we have good provings. I always refer to provings, and we do have to go back and read the provings to make sure that the person really needs the remedy we are thinking about. So the hair and the clothes might make us think of insects. With the clothes, I mean, again, a special interest in nice clothes, being well dressed, or having very colorful clothes, or buying a lot of clothes, or talking about other people's clothes, how nice they are or not nice, and how they like the being well dressed, and how they admire people who are well dressed, etc. Or they will spend a lot of money in buying clothes. In insects, there's another feature. We won't find it in birds so much. It can be there, but not so outspoken. And that's the idea that they are low and they aim to be high. So they fly, they do fly, but they fly from the low place to the high place. They fly away from something. They go somewhere from the dirt into the clear and the open space. It's not the issue in birds. Birds fly because they love to fly, because they love to feel the wind, and they love the speed, and they love the movement, not to get away from something, from the low and the dirt and the garbage and the filth, which is an issue in insect cases. Another very important thing is the metamorphosis. That is something specific to insects. We won't find it in birds. And of course, we know specifically of the butterflies, but we find it in many, many insects. There are different stages in the life of an insect, and they are completely different from one stage from another. So they have a complete metamorphosis. You wouldn't recognize it as the same animal if you wouldn't know that this caterpillar later, and the first, and the butterfly later, is the same species. So this metamorphosis is somehow very important in the patient. Either they say it literally, or you will find that what they're saying by synonyms conveys the same message. On the physical level, there are a few differences. Of course, it's a bit difficult to prescribe only on physical complaints, because in principle, every patient can have every possible physical ailment or disturbance, no matter what kingdom he belongs to. But there are areas that are more likely than others to be affected. So in insects, and we know this from remedies like Cantharis and Apis, it's especially the urinary tract and the bladder. So we know that these remedies that I just mentioned are famous for cystitis, and in general, all the insect remedies have or can have problems with the bladder. Cystitis, irritable bladder, burning urination, frequent urination, or inflammation in the whole urinary tract. That's kind of typical. So again, if you have different features coming together, this will set your mind to insects. Another feature they often have, on the one hand, they can be speedy and very active, but they can have the physical exhaustion, and this can be their main complaint. They like to work, they like to move, they like to do something. So because they like activity, because they like work, most of the insects do like to work and or to have activity somewhere, somehow, one way or another. And because they have the liking of the activity, or maybe the overdoing it, they will complain about the physical exhaustion. They would like to go back to their active state, because then they feel they are doing what they prefer to do. And you know this from remedies like Formica rufa, for instance, the activity and the working together. And in general, that's a general feature, most of the insect remedies are warm-blooded. This can always be a help when you go to your generalities. But I'm sure there is still a lot to learn about insects, and we have to, for the time being, almost rely completely on the recent provings of more and more insects.
So in this session, Anna taught us the main themes of birds and mammals and how to differentiate between birds and insects. We will leave the animal kingdom for now. Next session will be about the mineral kingdom, the issues in general and more specific those of the first, second and third row. In the meantime, we recommend that you consult the schemes on the Radar Opus program, read the book if necessary, and of course the best way is to attend the live classes, of which you'll find the program on Anna's website. Thank you for attending.